That's our friend here, so it looks like there's ideas here, and there are. So I've been hoisted by my own task here a bit. But having said that, they are the paintings that have resulted have not been planned before they started. So, for example, the painting behind you there, that's called Glass Planes. There was a glass fence behind that big flower shape. And the plant wasn't there, but it was started. So there was an evolutionary process throughout making the painting, which ended up with the final thing. So whilst there was an idea in what these paintings are trying to talk about or express, is that we have, for the last, since the Industrial Revolution has 200 years or so, we've seen nature as being a resource for our use. And increasingly, the natural world has become mechanized by what we have to read to it. And so, and I quite like the idea of these kind of metal flowers kind of appear. So, they've talked about rabbits, so even rabbits are rabbits. Allowed to exist in certain places. We have badger poles now, and altogether the badgers, of course, badgers aren't useful. So we're doing all this stuff. So there is a point to these paintings. And, hopefully, they have a motivation behind them, perhaps more than an idea. The paintings themselves develop with a life of their own and become. How they become. So we've got this one. I mean, it started off as that painting, and then. I felt it needed, having added in robots and things into other ones, I thought, okay, well, we need one in there. I couldn't find out a way of putting one in, so I stuck him on the side there. And that kind of unbalanced the whole thing, so I had to put a piece up there as well. And then sort of carried on the tune for this. So they're evolutionary kind of painters. So as you're painting them, they're evolving constantly and becoming something which surprises yourself. So whilst there is an idea behind them, they still don't conform to a kind of blueprint in my head as to what I'm going to do when I start painting. So hopefully that's kind of mitigated. I don't know. The interesting these paintings was that the first one was that. That was the first one, which, as I say, did start off being very industrial. The painting, it started off as I'm painting over one of the extremes. So there was a little kind of bit of one of some yums. So it had a little bit of kind of floral stuff going here. So then I painted it in, I left that bit there, so I thought, that's all right. I need that bit. But then that gradually grew and grew and grew, and got painted over, and the plant appeared, being suggested by the previous painting that somebody else had done entirely. So it's kind of interesting that the idea is there, the motivation is there to make the painting, but the paintings themselves evolve in their own way when they're doing it. So that was the second one, and the rabbit was a kind of a. And in fact, that was a painting I started before. That was a little hut. There was a hut there. That was a little garden of roses in, where all those purple trumpets are. And that was a painting which was kind of set about, well, let's carry on with that one. And that became these kind of trumpet shapes after seeing that flower arrive. So I said, okay, let's do that. So I'd done these two paper ones on the window, which sort of gave me the idea of these kind of trumpets and noises. So those two kind of were the first two. Then this one was kind of a bit of a relief for me. I felt the need to paint a little more optimistic, perhaps, or something a little more hopeful. So this little hut kind of appears, and there's one in there, there's one over there. There was one in there, but it's gone now. But this little hut is this kind of place where there's a simplicity of life, I suppose. There's a sort of sanctuary. This is called sanctuary. That seems to be right. So this is a kind of dream world where everything is simplified. You've got all this kind of stuff going on around you all the time. And the final one, talk about that one a bit. I guess I quite like the quizzical robot, which has kind of amused me. The sort of muteness of it as well. Can't say anything. Same with the rabbit. The rabbit's got no mouth.
Question mark.
Yeah, some questions. But then also, I also googled vintage robots and stuff like that. Follow this man, the sticky video, to Christian Marquette and turn up thing. Then that was the final painting. So that one, I was kind of getting close to the deadline. So I thought I needed something to actually sort of culminate all this kind of show. And I'm not sure, I think it's gone the same way as the last storyline. I'm not entirely comfortable with it in some ways, because it's become a bit too literal. I prefer the kind of poetry of the other images than that one. But I like it, but it does say something. It's all kind of, conformist robots wondering about the clown beating the drum.
It's a very scary clown, though.
Yeah, well, that's why I put a clown there. So the clowns are scary. Yeah. So I didn't want to be funny. I wanted to have something like a queasy feeling.
See, the robot's scared.
Enjoy giving them expressions.
That's something, the person I work with, Terence, his pages are full of people, and no one ever writes my pages. It really annoys me. I would love somebody just to appear. but they never do. So that's the closest I've come. I've kind of got surrogate people in the form of robots, so I don't know what that says, really. But that's kind of, again, that's something that it's in me, and I'm doing something. But I think all the paintings are the same. Really have something similar to them. But what I quite like about a show like this is seeing them together. Is that the mood is kind of consistent, even though the subject is different. But there's still something there which is me. So that's it.
But you reckon if it was genuine, it'd be a lot.
Ian, why don't you have a signing picture?
I don't know. I like them just as they are. I mean, it's one of those things. I signed one back, so it's recognised as mine.
It's okay for investments then. Yeah.
I don't think they do the image of it. They have my name there. The image is the image. It's the painting. It's not me. Any other questions?
Yeah, what do you think about the use of colour in that one?
Well, actually, this one, I use a slightly different palette for this one, so you really think about it. Those four are all painted with a Pavicore palette, so it's azure and crimson, Prussian blue, lemon yellow, and white, basically.
They're all by his
But this one, the sort of caviar yellow, caviar red, and marine, so you get a warm up. So I thought for a more optimistic painting, warmer palette seems to suit you. So it's a question of I like to use a vintage palette because it's very hard, it's very easy to end up with muddy pictures. If you use all the colours you're mixing, you're not quite sure what you're mixing. But if say you want that kind of green, then it's a lemon yellow and a cool blue and white. If you use a warm yellow and a warm blue, you won't get that green. Mm-hmm. So you have to sort of choose your palette. So this is kind of like, say you were you're making a film, and you've got all the set there and everyone's there ready to go. You're trying to create a mood. You have to get the lighting to be right, the cinematography to be right, everything to be right to create the right kind of mood. So that's what I'm trying to do, is honing on a particular kind of palette that suits the mood of the paintings. And trying to keep it simple so that you get a lot of colour out of very small
paintings. A lot you were describing with that one's while you're making work, maybe an emotional tone or something comes into being and you kind of identify and follow it.
I think that's good. If it didn't feel like it, then you have to change it. You paint it, don't look at that, it's not quite what I'm looking for. You have to do something else. it's a kind of, suck it and see it all the time. Okay, well, let's try that. You have to be a little bit brave, we started painting that and last minute saying I was painting that. It's not really wrong. It doesn't feel right, so you need to just do it, just carry on. Try and end up with something to do that.
How do you know when you finished speaking about ending up?
Well, that's a tricky one.
oh, I know, the day before the deadline.
Yeah, the deadline. The deadline is always a good one. I think, actually, a lot of the paintings, they start off, they do get to a point where they're much tighter than they are at the moment. And I'm like, oh, man, that's good. So then they have to sort of knock them back again. So you go back to where they were. But it's just judging when they feel. That's where we sort of think, okay. I think it's also you end up thinking, I don't know what else to do. So you just stop. Yeah. I don't know how to make this better anymore. You know, it's not to try and make it better. You get to, I don't know how to make it better. So you stop. And then, I tend to do is, my students are really big, since outside this room. So I've got easels which I put around the house and just stick them up. And so it starts something else. And then you might walk past it and think, oh yeah, that one's a bit, and take it back in and start again and do a bit more. So it's a kind of process where you're looking for the recognition and the object. It's soliciting you to do something, ask you to carry on. And then eventually it stops asking you to respond. I just thought that was quite good. Actually, I did write something on the right, which I thought would be a good ending end point. But it just came to me. Let's see if I can find it. So I was just trying to work out what I was going to say to you today. I wrote this last night and said, artworks are just one part of me. They hold up a mirror to show who I am. Hopefully people recognise something, resonates with them. That's the important part. That's kind of what I hope is that people will see that and think, okay, that's interesting. That's it, right? Okay.